Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribaradhari. Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribaradhari. Gopi Jana Vallabha Giribaradhari. Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Yasoda Nandana Braja Jana Ranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Hare. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada. Jaya Guru Deva, Jaya Guru Deva, Guru Deva, Jaya Guru Deva. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namane Namaste Sarasati Devam Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschachadeshatarine Om Aghanata Marandasya Ganangana Shalakaya Chakshuhun Militam Yena Tasmaye Shri Guruve Namaha. So today is Śrīmad Bhagavatam class, Canto 1, Chapter 18, Text 49. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Iti putra-kṛtāghena. So nutapto mahā-muni. Svayaṁ viprakṛto raja. Naivāghaṁ tad acintayat. Iti putra-kṛtāghena. So nutapto mahā-muniḥ. Svayaṁ viprakṛto raja. Naivāghaṁ tad acintayat. Iti putra-kṛtāghena. So nutapto mahā-muniḥ. Svayam viprakṛto raja. Naivāghaṁ tad acintayat. Thus, putra, son, kṛta, done by, aghena, by the sin, sa, he, the muni, anutaptaḥ, regretting, mahā-muniḥ, the sage, svayam, personally, viprakṛta, being so insulted, rājñā, by the king, na, not, eva, certainly, agham, the sin, tat, that acintayat, thought of it. Translation. The sage thus regretted the sin committed by his own son. He did not take the insult paid by the king very seriously. Purport. The whole incident, purport by Śrīla Prabhupāda, the whole incident is now cleared up. Mahārāja Parīkṣit's garlanding the sage with a dead snake was not at all a very serious offense. But Śrīṅgi's cursing the king was a serious offense. The serious offense was committed by a foolish child only. Therefore, he deserved to be pardoned by the Supreme Lord, although it was not possible to get free from the sinful reaction. Mahārāja Parīkṣit also did not mind the curse offered to him by a foolish brāhmaṇa. On the contrary, he took full advantage of the awkward situation, and by the great will of the Lord, Mahārāja Parīkṣit achieved the highest perfection of life through the grace of Śrīla Śukadeva Gosvāmī. Actually, it was the desire of the Lord and Mahārāja Parīkṣit, Ṛṣi Śamīka and his son Śṛṅgi were all instrumental in fulfilling the desire of the Lord. So none of them were put into difficulty because everything was done in relation with the Supreme Lord. So, the king, he did not take this as a serious offense. So, Mahārāja Parīkṣit did not really commit an offense because the muni, he did not accept this as an offense. But his son, he committed an offense because he cursed Mahārāja Parīkṣit. But because he's a child, then he's excused. It's considered that women, children, brahmanas, they're considered innocent and they're not punishable. I should mention that when Vishvamitra, when he took Ram and Lakshman to the forest, and there was a huge, big Rakshasa demon woman, and so when she appeared, Vishvamitra told Ram, "You kill her immediately." And Ram said, "But women are innocent, they're not punishable." And then Vishvamitra said to him that a woman, the qualities of a woman, that they are affectionate, that they are supporting, and he listed the qualities of a woman. And so he said to Ram, "She does not have these qualities. She is killing and eating the rishis. So she is not a woman. There is no sin in killing her." So women, children, brahmanas, they're innocent and they're not punishable. So then Prabhupada, in the end of this purport, he mentions that this was the arrangement of Krishna. For Mahārāja Parīkṣit to be cursed by Śrīṅgi, this was all under the personal direction of Krishna. He arranged this. So therefore, because this is a pastime created by Krishna, then no one is really punishable. And so Mahārāja Parīkṣit, you know, when he was cursed, then he didn't get upset, he didn't get angry. He accepted this as Krishna's arrangement. And for devotees who can accept the suffering in life as Krishna's arrangement, accept that this is my reaction to my sinful activities, and continue their devotional service, they are sure to get Krishna Prem. Without this mentality, very difficult to get Krishna Prem. Because this is what Krishna expects from us. When Lord Brahma, when he became conscious and the universe was dark, he was the only one there. So he heard the words tapa, tapa, which means austerity and penance. So this is Krishna's arrangement for us. He wants us to perform austerities and penances. He wants us to show and to prove to him that we really want him. You know, we have to prove to Krishna that we don't want, you know, material enjoyment. We don't want mystic yoga cities. We don't want liberation. This Krishna expects us to prove to him that we don't want these things, that we want Krishna Prem. And Prabhupada came to give Krishna Prem. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, what he came to give was Krishna Prem. So Krishna Prem is the ultimate goal, is the highest goal of life. And so Krishna, just like Mahārāja Parīkṣit, when he renounced everything, and he went outside the kingdom, then immediately Śukadeva Gosvāmī appeared. Just like that. So when Śukadeva Gosvāmī, when Mahārāja Parīkṣit, when he saw Śukadeva Gosvāmī, he said to Śukadeva Gosvāmī, he said, I understand that my meeting you is an arrangement by the will of divine providence. So this is Krishna's arrangement. Prabhupada once said, you don't find Guru, Guru finds you. So Mahārāja Parīkṣit, he only heard out of those nine processes of devotional service, he did one, Śravanam. Śravanam is the beginning. Without Śravanam, how can you chant? How can you remember? Śravanam is the most important thing. I want to quote something about Śravanam from Prabhupada. I need three phones here, you know. Anyway. So, this is a purport from Śrīmad Bhagavatam. Prabhupada's purport, Śrīmad Bhagavatam, 4.20.25. A pure Vaishnava engages in the service of the Lord, taking shelter of his lotus feet, and therefore he has a direct connection with the saffron mercy particles that are strewn over the lotus feet of the Lord. Prabhupada's so poetic. So one of the symptoms of a pure devotee that he's poetic. Although when a pure devotee speaks the articulation, although when a pure devotee speaks, the articulation of his voice may resemble the sound of this material sky. the voice is spiritually very powerful because it touches because it touches the particles of saffron dust on the lotus feet of the Lord. As soon as a sleeping living entity hears the powerful voice emanating from the mouth of a pure devotee, he immediately remembers his eternal relationship with the Lord, although up until that moment he had forgotten everything. So the conditioned soul, he has forgotten Krishna. I am the controller, I am the enjoyer, I am the owner. This mentality, this consciousness is directly opposed to Krishna consciousness. So Prabhupada is saying here, when someone hears from a pure Vaishnava, those sound vibrations, they are not material. They are spiritual sound vibrations. Krishna appears to within the heart of a devotee from the words of his guru, from the words of his spiritual master. Because those sound vibrations, they are Krishna. So when one is hearing from a pure Vaishnava, he is experiencing Krishna. So because of that experience of Krishna, then one remembers his relationship with Krishna. We have a relationship with Krishna in some form or another. It's in a seed-like form within the soul. Just like a mango seed, everything is there. The leaves, the branches, the roots, the fruit. It's only when the mango seed sprouts and then grows. So similarly, from hearing from pure Vaishnavas, then that is considered the watering of the Bhakti Lata beach. So when the Bhakti Lata beach is being watered by the nectar from the lips of pure Vaishnavas, then the Bhakti Lata Beja will sprout and then will grow, and eventually the branches will grow, the creepers and the leaves, and then eventually the flowers will manifest. But all these are there within the jiva. Whether the relationship is with as in a neutral relationship, as friendship, in parental love or in conjugal love, that is there within every jiva. Although because we are coming in the line of Rupa Goswami, then many devotees who are coming in this line, they have a relationship with Krishna in Madhura Ras, in Vrindavan. So, but that doesn't mean that all devotees that come in this line have this relationship. Even some devotees can have a relationship with Narayan in Vaikuntha. But because the acharyas in our line, they have the topmost love, Madhura Ras, then they can give parental love. Hare Krishna.
Is this still going?
No. can everyone hear okay? Yeah? Okay. I don't need to yell. So they can give parental love, they can give friendship with Krishna, they can give neutral relationship, and even Vaikuntha Prem they can give. A guru who has Vaikuntha Prem, he cannot give Braj Prem. But someone who has Braj Prem, he can give Vaikuntha Prem. Anyway. Yes, so Prabhupada is saying. And then Prabhupada continues, for a conditioned soul, therefore, it is very important to hear from the mouth of a pure devotee who is fully surrendered to the lotus feet of the Lord without any material desire, speculative knowledge, or contamination of the modes of nature. So we can understand, you know, who a pure devotee is. Prabhupada is saying here, someone who is fully surrendered to the lotus feet of the Lord without any material desire, speculative knowledge, or contamination of the modes of nature. Rupa Goswami wrote one verse, Anya bilashita shunyam jnana karma janabitam anukulyena krishnanu shilanam bhaktir uttama. So he gave the example of honey. When honey is being poured from a jar, then it's unbroken. As the honey is pouring, it's pouring in an unbroken thread. So devotional service should be continuous without any break. Hare Krishna, we're back. Welcome to India. what was I saying? Without a break. It should be without a break. So, and also, devotional service to Krishna should be free from any desire, any material desire, any desire for yogic cities, any desire for liberation. When one is in this state, one is freed from the three modes of material nature. So Prabhupada is giving an explanation from who we should hear. Because when we hear from a pure Vaishnava who is free from the influence of Maya, those words, they're not ordinary words. We can't compare. Like when we chant, then that chanting, unless Krishna is dancing on our tongue, unless tears are coming from our eyes, and unless we have no desire for material enjoyment, if we are free from Maya, unless we like this, that sound vibration is not pure. Just like bhakti, when it's performed with material desires, it's not pure bhakti. It's karma, misra, bhakti. It's mixed. So, you know, the ultimate goal of human life is Krishna Prem. So to achieve Krishna Prem, one has to be free from Maya. So that performance of sadhana bhakti, of sadhana bhakti under direction of a pure Vaishnava, that will elevate us to the platform of raganuga bhakti. And this is all done from hearing. Like even when Guru gives an instruction, you're hearing that. So Shravanam is the center around which everything revolves in bhakti. And Prabhupada is saying here, you know, who we should hear from. If Prabhupada is writing this in his books, there's no need for speculation. There's no need for imaginations. Everything there is in Prabhupada's books. Prabhupada has given us everything. Prabhupada was cutting jungles. You know, was it? Nirvishesha Shunyavadi. Prabhupada Prabhupada was dealing with impersonalists, Mayavadis, and Nirvishesha Buddhists. Anyway, I get confused sometimes. So, so sadhana bhakti is performed when the jiva is in when the jiva is conditioned. I am this body. This is my parents. This is my country, my worshipable country. So. When one is in this condition, it's considered a contaminated condition of the soul. So this contamination, it can be cleared by performing sadhana bhakti under directions of pure Vaishnava. There's a definition of pure bhakti given let's see, where is that? There's a different definition given in Bhagavatam. I don't have it. But anyway, one of the conditions, one of the main conditions is that here it is. Sorry, this is in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila 22, 105. When transcendental devotional service, by which love for Krishna is attained, is executed by the senses, it is called sadhana bhakti, or the regulative discharge of devotional service. Such devotional service eternally exists within the heart of every living entity. The awakening of this eternal devotion is the potentiality of devotional service in practice. So this is a really nice description of sadhana bhakti. Sadhana, like in the stage when the jiva is conditioned, then what is he thinking about? I mean, whatever our attachments are, then our mind will be absorbed in those things. So the mind is absorbed in what? Kam, krodh, lobh, matsarya, moha, lust, anger, greed, envy, madness, and illusion. So it's a very helpless condition of the jiva in this state. So by performing bhakti with the senses, then one develops emotions. In the beginning, we don't have an attraction to Krishna. We don't have any feelings or emotions for Krishna. I mean, if we look at the descriptions of Radharani's feelings for Krishna, she exemplifies, the emotions and feelings that a devotee has for Krishna. When she sees Krishna, she faints. In separation from Krishna, she's thinking only of Krishna. She's not thinking of anything else. There is no lust, anger, greed, envy, madness, or illusion in Radharani. Not material. So she's, and even when she's with Krishna, she knows that there will be separation. So when she realizes that this union of Krishna there will come a separation from this. So she becomes so absorbed in the mood of separation that she's not even aware that she's with Krishna at that time. So even in union, there's separation. And in separation, there's union, because she's always thinking of Krishna. So because of her absorption with Krishna, she's with Krishna at the time of separation. So, by performing sadhana bhakti, we can't develop the emotions of Radharani, but we can develop emotions for Krishna, depending on what our relationship with Krishna is. So sadhana bhakti, by performing sadhana bhakti with the senses and direction of pure Vaishnava, then slowly these emotions will begin to develop. Like in Kanishtha stage, when one is doing sadhana bhakti, there's different levels of Kanishtha. I think there's Kanishtha. Then there's Kanishtha, Madhyam. Then there's Kanishtha, Madhyam, Madhyam. Then there's Kanishtha, Madhyam, Uttam. Like this. So there's different stages, different levels. So as one advances, these emotions will begin to develop. And even though one doesn't have Krishna Prem, he will be able to experience, you know, the some happiness and some feelings for Krishna. And these feelings, they gradually grow, until one comes to the stage of ruchi, when a devotee is experiencing emotions and so much happiness in Krishna consciousness when they're chanting and doing service. So sadhana bhakti, it leads us to raganuga bhakti. And raganuga bhakti is a stage when one has feelings for Krishna. So now there's a definition of raganuga bhakti. It's in Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhyalila 23.5. When devotional service is executed on the transcendental platform of pure goodness, it is like a sun ray of love for Krishna. At such a time, devotional service causes the heart to be softened by various tastes, and one is then situated in bhav, emotion. So, Vishvanatha Chakravarti Thakur, he in Madhura Kandambini, he's explained the different levels that a devotee goes through from the beginning, which is Shraddha. After Shraddha, there's Sadhusanga. After Sadhusanga, because when we have Sadhusanga, we're hearing from pure Vaishnavas. So they're hearing of the nectar from the lips of pure Vaishnavas, it transforms the heart, and one becomes more and more attracted to Krishna. So after Sadhusanga is Diksha, when one gets the mantras and one surrenders himself unto Guru and he follows, as explained here, in the definition of sadhan bhakti, he's engaging his senses in sadhan, in vaidhi bhakti. And at that stage of vaidhi bhakti, when the mind is full of lust, anger, greed, envy, madness and illusion, he can fall from that stage very easily, like a drop of water on a lotus leaf. Just a little wind can come and the lotus leaf can topple and that drop of water will fall. This example is given by, I think it's by Rupa Goswami. So, So in this stage of sadhan, of Vaidhi Bhakti, because of material desires, one can easily fall. Because Maya, she has two potencies. She has a covering potency and then she has a throwing potency. So ordinary people, they are covered. You know, this is my country, this is my body, this is my family, my wife, my children, my BMW. And they are not concerned about anything else. They are not concerned about getting liberation or freedom. So the covering potency keeps them within this world. But when a devotee, when he begins sadhan bhakti, then his material desires, he becomes very, very much aware. Like if someone's begins to fast, then he'll feel much more hunger than he normally does. So when the mind is restricted from material enjoyment, then the mind, the hunger of the mind, the lust of the mind increases so much more. So this is the throwing potency of Maya. When a devotee wants to become free from the covering potency, then Maya has another potency and she will try and throw him back. And this is a test for the devotee. How much do you actually want Krishna? So that's why a devotee can fall down very easily. Like Ajamil, he's an example. He was born in a very high class Brahmin family. You know, Brahmins are like gods, you know. They're truthful, they're honest, they're trustworthy. The list of brahmanas is so long and so wonderful. They're not ordinary human beings, and only a small percentage of humans within human society, for the whole history of, you know, human society, only a small percentage are actually brahmins. And then Bilva Mangala Thakur is another example. You know, he's a devotee. He was taking instruction from Chintamani. There's a few opinions about his relationship with Chintamani. But the thing is, she was giving him instruction. So if Bilva Mangala Thakur's heart is melting from hearing the instruction of Chintamani, is she a prostitute? You know? Anyway, we won't get into that. That's another discussion. But so Bilva Mangala Thakur, by hearing from Chintamani, he became inspired in Krishna consciousness. So he left and decided to go to Vrindavan. But he was so lusty. Every woman he saw, he was so attracted to. So one woman he was attracted to, he asked for needles in her hair to keep her hair, and he poked his eyes out. Now this is a sign of sincerity. If we do that, we'll probably regret that. So, you know, we shouldn't imitate high-class devotees. We should follow, but not imitate. And so, so the platform of sadhana bhakti is like that. And as one develops feelings, like Bharat Maharaj, he became attached to a deer. But he was very, very elevated devotee. He was on the level of Bab. So even someone from the level of Bab can fall down. So even from the level of Raganuga Bhakti, still one can fall down, but generally it doesn't happen. And the reason why Bharat Maharaj, was it Bharat Maharaj? Yeah. The reason why he fell down, because in that life he didn't have sadhu sangha and he wasn't hearing the nectar from the lips of pure Vaishnavas. That's why he fell down. So this is a lesson for all of us, that if we don't hear from the nectar of Krishna's pastimes from the lips of a pure Vaishnava, we can easily fall down. So so Krishna consciousness becomes very pleasurable in the stage of Raganuga Bhakti, because those feelings, when they're rising to the conscious awareness, they're rising from the soul, because pure Vaishnavas, they create transformations within the heart at the same time as our attraction for Krishna is developing, then our attraction for material pleasure is dwindling. They happen at the same time, and it's a gradual, slow process. In this body, we can't really experience Krishna Prema because we'll die. Because Krishna Prema is so intense, our physical body cannot tolerate that ecstasy. But Bhav is a level of ecstasy that the physical body can tolerate. Like once Prabhupada was giving a class, he was beginning a class, this is in Melbourne, Australia, and he was chanting Jai Radha Madhava. And halfway through chanting Jai Radha Madhava, we could see tears were coming from Prabhupada's eyes. He was in so much ecstasy. Even once he gave one lecture I can't remember, in US somewhere. He gave a lecture on the day, on the anniversary of his sannyas. And Bhakti Keshava Maharaj gave him sannyas. So on that anniversary, he was glorifying Maharaj. And at the end, he just broke down in tears, was crying. And he said, thank you very much. And then Prabhupada had left. He couldn't talk anymore. And even Keshava Maharaj, whenever he would give classes, whenever he would talk about Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj, he would burst out crying and he couldn't continue. So then he would ask one of two of his disciples to continue the Harikatha. So we can see, like in our acharyas, we can see the symptoms of ecstasy. There's so many stories about them when they're experiencing ecstasy. One of my favorites is when Rupa Goswami, he was in samadhi, and he lost external consciousness, and he was absorbed in his service of Radharani in Braj, in Vrindavan. So while he was in this state, one neophyte devotee who was like crippled and he was walking very awkwardly. So he walked in front of Rupa Goswami, and Rupa Goswami, because of his ecstasy, In samadhi, he had a smile on his face. So this devotee when he saw Rupa Goswami had a smile on his face, he thought that he was laughing at him because he's walking so crookedly. So when Rupa Goswami came out of Samadhi, he told Sanatana Goswami, he said, I've lost all my taste for chanting. I can't chant. So Sanatana Goswami said, you have committed Vaishnava Aparad, because it's only by Vaishnava Aparad you will lose the taste for chanting. So Sanatana Goswami, he said, we can find out who thinks that you did Aparad, although you didn't do Aparad consciously. But unconsciously there is Aparad, so we will hold a big feast, the devotee, and invite all the devotees in Braj, and the one that doesn't come, he's the one that feels offended by you. So they did that, and this one devotee didn't come. So Rupa Goswami, you know, Rupa Goswami, he begged that devotee. He was begging and begging and begging, please forgive me. What humility is that? And Ambarish Maharaj, when Duvasa Muni, when he tried to kill Ambarish Maharaj, then Krishna sent the Sudarsan Chakra. He went everywhere. He asked Lord Shiva, Brahma, everyone. No one could help him. And then eventually he went to Vaikuntha. And he asked Narayan, please help me, please save me. And Narayan said, I can't help you because you have offended my devotee. The only way that you can become free from the Sudarshan Chakra is by asking for forgiveness from Ambarish Maharaj. Okay, any questions? If there's no questions, I will just continue. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. I have a question regarding the levels that you mentioned, Kanishta, 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 Madhyama, and so on. Where can we read more in details about these different levels?
You're talking about what levels? I didn't. Can you speak a little slowly because the Indian accent is difficult for me to understand.
Okay, you mentioned in your class,
yes,
that there are different levels.
Yes.
Kanishta, Kanishta, Kanishta. Kanishta, Kanishta, Madhyama.
Yes.
Kanishta, Madhyama, Uttama. Like that, different levels. I would like to read more about this subject matter. So I'm humbly requesting you for the reference.
Well, you find these this information from writings of Rupa Goswami and other Goswamis. So I had the good fortune of hearing these things, of hearing Rupa Goswami's writings, but I don't know Sanskrit. This specific topic that you're talking about, yeah, you know. But so I can't direct you anywhere that you get that information from. I was just fortunate because I just happened to be at the right time at the right place. Someone was giving a lecture and they were quoting Rupa Goswami. And even the where that is in Rupa Goswami's writings, I don't know. I should know. I'm sorry. But there, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there's so much rasa kata. You can, you know, if you want to know more about rasa kata, there's so much there, because Chaitanya Charitamrita is the postgraduate study. Okay. All right. Any other questions? All right, so I just want to read quickly where Prabhupada is talking about hearing from pure Vaishnavas. Bhakti Vinod Thakur. I just want to read one song of Bhakti Vinod Thakur. It's called Ohe Vaishnav Thakur. So Bhakti Vinod Thakur, he is saying in this song, O venerable Vaishnava, O ocean of mercy, be merciful unto your servant. Give me the shade of your lotus feet and purify me. I hold unto your lotus feet. Teach me to control my six passions, rectify my six faults, bestow upon me the six qualities, and offer unto me the six kinds of holy association. I do not find the strength to carry on alone the sankirtan of the holy name of Hari. Please bless me. Give me just one drop of faith with which to obtain the great treasure of the holy name of Krishna. Krishna is yours. You have the power to give him to me. I am simply running behind you, shouting, Krishna, Krishna. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he's giving, you know, information on how we can get Krishna Prem. It's by mercy of pure Vaishnava. He's running, and he's running after the Vaishnavas. He's running behind, shouting, Krishna, Krishna. So, I mean, this is indirectly, this is the description of sadhana bhakti, is that he's asking the Vaishnava to free him from all the problems associated with performing bhakti. And so he's saying, I'm running behind you shouting Krishna, Krishna. So with his senses, he is performing bhakti. So this is sadhana bhakti. This is one example of sadhana bhakti. So the six passions are those pertaining to words, the mind, anger, the tongue, the stomach, and the genitals. The six faults are overeating, attachment to material things, inability to follow regulative principles, sense gratification, useless idle talk, and impure habits. The six positive qualities are enthusiasm in practicing devotional service, firm faith in devotional process, a strong desire to attain prema bhakti, a favorable service attitude, avoidance of non-devotees, and appreciation of the company of the devotees. The six methods of association are to go to an assembly of devotees, to invite devotees into one's home, to discuss and hear devotional topics, to take the mahaprasad of devotees, and to offer mahaprasad to devotees. So the six positive qualities, out of those six, a strong desire to attain prema bhakti is the necessary requirement. If we have this strong desire to attain Krishna bhakti, then everything else will follow. Just like Mahārāja Parīkṣit, he had a very strong desire for Krishna bhakti. So Krishna sent Śukadeva Gosvāmī. So Krishna will look after us. You know, even one may get a guru who falls down. But if one is giving the proper respect to guru, Krishna, he sees that. So then he will send the real guru. So one shouldn't be despondent, one shouldn't be disheartened. If we follow the process as outlined by our acharyas and by Prabhupada, then even we fall down, even our guru falls down, Krishna will look after us if we are sincere. Okay, I'll stop here. Gaura Pramanandi Hari Hari Bo Vanchikalpati Rubisha Kripasandu Biyabichapati Dhanapavani Bivaishnavevi Namo Namaha. Thank you very much for listening. Hare Krishna.